Before there was Ellen Ripley, before there was Wonder Woman, there was the original action heroine, Atalanta. Now available at Amazon, Smashwords, and at studiobrainstorm.net. Links in the description. Darth Maul, a character that at this point needs no introduction, has almost no lines of dialogue, and is fundamentally little more than the right-hand man of the overarching Big Bad, but with stellar makeup designed by concept artist Ian McKaig, some of the best, if not the best, fight choreography in all the films, courtesy of Ray Park, and one of John Williams' most iconic themes overplaying it all, it seemed that all the artistic stars aligned just right to create an iconic villain. So much so that two different animated series insisted on bringing him back, almost to the point where the character began to overstay his welcome. Although it is to the credit, grudgingly, of post-Disney Star Wars that they did give him the proper send-off he deserved. But before Rebels or the Clone Wars or even before the prequel films were done, there were people at Lucasfilm who saw the potential of Darth Maul and decided to explore him through my favorite medium, the printed word. Enter Darth Maul Shadow Hunter, the prequel to the prequels, if you will, as it is a storyline set within less than a month of the beginning of The Phantom Menace. Initially, I planned to do Shadow Hunter all on its lonesome. Partly because, yet again, no votes were cast in either of my polls, and two, because after the surprising amount of effort it took in my latest amount of lore videos, I felt a lighter workload would be welcome. At least for me, anyway. But then I discovered that the edition of Shadow Hunter that I was using included a bonus short story, and I decided, why not? Thus, as a sort of appetizer before the entree, Darth Maul Saboteur by regular Star Wars author James Luceno. Since this is a short story, I'm going to save a more detailed background for Luceno for when I do one of his novels, but suffice it to say, this man has been a regular Star Wars writer since the turn of the millennium. His Star Wars bibliography includes three separate entries in the 19-volume New Jedi Order series, including the final novel, The Unifying Force, as well as several standalone features like Cloak of Deception, Labyrinth of Evil, Tarkin, and Darth Plagueis. So, Saboteur takes place before Shadowhunter, some indeterminate number of months before the Trade Federation blockades Naboo. Darth Sidious, malignant Machiavellian mastermind that he is determined to make sure that his Trade Federation pawns, specifically Newt Gunray, their viceroy, are firmly in his pocket. After all, as his own apprentice Darth Maul points out, Nemoidians aren't exactly the most reliable of beings in a galaxy far, far away. In fact, there's a nice moment in their conversation where Maul tells his master that he thinks Nemoidians are greedy, weak-willed, and unworthy, and Sidious, without missing a beat, says, quote, "You left out duplicitous and sniveling." Yet, he continues to insist that the Trade Federation will play an important role in his plan to bring down the Jedi. And so, for as long as he needs Newt Gunray, Sidious is determined to make sure that the Viceroy is both grateful to his secret Sith benefactor and absolutely terrified of what might happen to him if he should even think of double-crossing said benefactor. And it would seem that the Sith Lord has found the perfect way to kill both Minox with one stone. Recently, Newt Gunray has taken an interest in acquiring the mostly obscure mining colony world of Dorvala. The world has potential for great profit, and its acquisition would not only benefit the Trade Federation, but as the one to acquire it himself, it would be a nice feather in the Viceroy's cap and almost guarantee a promotion to the Directorate, the governing body of the Trade Federation. However, thus far, Gunray has been unsuccessful in his acquisition. Crucially, Gunray has never mentioned this to Sidious, not because he's trying to hide something, but simply because he doesn't think it's relevant to his business with the Dark Lord of the Sith. But of course Sidious knows all this because he's got his own spies. This, Sidious decides, will be Darth Maul's mission. Go to Darvala and manipulate events so as to guarantee the Trade Federation acquisition. This way, Sidious can effectively gift the mining world to Gunray, thus ensuring his continued gratitude, while also letting him know that there is no secret in the galaxy that he doesn't know about, thus also ensuring the Nemoidians' continued fear of him. Two Minox indeed. Before Maul departs on his mission, his master asks the Zabrak why he decided to create a double-bladed lightsaber for himself instead of a standard one. When Maul replies that it simply made sense to him to be able to strike his enemy with both sides of his lightsaber, Sidious tells his apprentice to keep those words in mind when he goes to Darvala. His final words to his apprentice are an admonition to maintain secrecy. It is still too early for the Sith to reveal themselves. Luceno gives Sidious a pretty nice line of dialogue, too. Quote, "What is done in secret has great power. A sword master knows that when he flourishes his blade, he reveals his intent." But that is only the first half of the setup for Saboteur. The other half comes courtesy of the only other significant POV character, Patch Brewitt, chief of field operations for one of the mining companies on Darvala. Darvala is a world in the Videnda sector of the Outer Rim, which, funnily enough, isn't all that far from the Grumani sector, the setting of the Knight-Errant series. It's a small, relatively undeveloped world whose primary export is lomite, a mineral used in important alloys like transparasteel and durasteel. Hence the two mining companies, Lomite Limited, which Brewitt works for under the Corellian-born human journal Arant, and Intergalactic Ore, which is mostly run by Felines for some reason. Brewitt has worked for Lomite Limited for at least 20 years and is basically at the point where he is just sick and tired of his job, but unfortunately there doesn't seem to be any other option for him. The fact that there have been multiple sabotage attempts on Lomite Limited and the fact that he gets flack for it from his boss every time it happens doesn't help matters. As if the rivalry with IGO isn't bad enough, the Trade Federation has been desperately trying to get its greedy mitts on Darvala for some time now, not only because of the profit, but also, by doing so, it would enable the Trade Federation to represent Darvala in the Senate and thus increase their political clout. It also shows the corruption of the Republic government at this stage that at some point when Brewitt asked Arant if he might want to go through official channels to resolve the matter, Arant says that it would merely be a question of who could give the biggest bribes to the most senators, which would only bankrupt them in the long run. Now though, after the latest sabotage, things are heating up. Darvala's neighbor, the planet Eriadu, one of the more up-and-coming systems of the Outer Rim, has just placed an immense order for Lomite to whichever of the two companies can deliver it first. And Arant is determined that it will be Lomite Limited that does it. And so he tasks Brewitt with finding some way of sabotaging intergalactic ore, giving Brewitt full authority to do whatever it takes as long as it doesn't blow up in their faces. And so, in the midst of all this corporate maneuvering and espionage, Darth Maul arrives on Darvala to undertake his mission. He goes to the company town built up around Lomite Limited and drops by the local waterhole to see if he can pick up any information that could be useful to him. Of course, because Saboteur is a short story with neither the time or page space to meander, this almost immediately pays off. Not only does Maul successfully identify a pair of Lomite Limited security men with some very loose lips, he also discovers a group of agents from Intergalactic Ore who are themselves spying on the Lomite Limited people by use of a listening device shaped like an insect, a literal bug. Maul then follows the security men to a meeting with Patch Brewitt, where he in turn lays out their plan to sabotage Intergalactic Ore's chances of winning the shipping contract from Eriadu. This mostly revolves around hiring a local gang of scavengers turned pirates called the Tomb Clan. During this conversation with his men, Brewitt expresses his frustration with life on Darvala and openly espouses the wish that both companies would go under so that something better could be made from the ashes. Maul records the entire conversation and then later sneaks into Brewitt's room and hacks his personal data files. As essentially second in command at Lomite Limited, this gives him access to the company's entire data repository. And from all this gathered information, he devises the plan that will serve his master's end. striking at both sides just as Darth Sidious had advised him. The following day, when the undercover intergalactic ore agents resume their usual stakeout listening in to the Lomite Limited people, Maul uses the Force to send their own bug over to their table, and then uses it to broadcast an audio-mixed version of the conversation Bruett had with his security men, making it sound like a representative of the Tomb Clan. The message reveals Lomite Limited's dealing with the Tomb Clan, but also implies that the Tomb Clan is willing to make an alternate deal with Intergalactic Ore to sabotage their rival instead. Of course, the Intergalactic people go scurrying off to their superiors, who in turn contact the Tomb Clan. The Tomb Clan are notoriously greedy, so of course, when the Intergalactic Ore representative contacts them, informs them of their offer and that they're willing to pay 150,000 credits, triple the 50,000 Bruett and Lomite Limited paid them, rather than deny or even question this strange offer, the leader of the Tomb Clan simply accepts the offer and schemes to sabotage both Lomite shipments, take the credits, and run. Both sabotages work perfectly. The two cargo freighters from both companies are arranged to smash into one another and blow up their cargo just as they arrive in system at Eriadu, also while the leaders of both businesses are meeting with several local Eriadu magnates and its lieutenant governor, a certain Wilhuff Tarkin. While Arant nearly collapses from the realization that Lomite Limited is all but ruined now, Bruett realizes immediately that the Tomb Clan has double-crossed both companies. He then meets with his opposite number at Intergalactic Ore, and the two sides agree to briefly unite in order to exact vengeance upon the pirates. Of course, the Tomb Clan by this point had already absconded, completely abandoning their home base on Dorvala and fleeing to a secret backup base, but Maul easily tracks them to a small ice world called Ryome. He then goes back to the original Dorvala base and plants just enough evidence for Bruett and the Intergalactic Ore people to find, thus pointing them in the right direction. All he has to do then is then follow them to Ryome, sit back, and let the company men and pirates slaughter each other, then swoop in and wipe out those who are left. Bruett is the last to die, and in his final moments, he realizes that this strange Jedi with the red lightsaber is the one who has been behind all that's happened. He has just enough time to ask Maul why he did all this, and the Sith apprentice simply responds that it was for a greater purpose before killing him. But Maul isn't done just yet. For his final trick, the Sith apprentice left one final recording in the wreckage of the original Tomb Clan base on Dorvala just after Bruett and the Intergalactic Ore people headed off for Ryome. The recording is discovered by an agent sent by Arant to investigate the matter, and like the one that Maul dangled in front of the undercover Intergalactic Ore agents, it's heavily doctored. This time to make it sound as though Bruett and Intergalactic Ore's own chief of security had been the masterminds behind the sabotage from the very beginning. This seeming betrayal, plus the fact that now both Lomite Limited and Intergalactic Ore no longer have ships to transport their Lomite ore, and replacing them would be far too expensive, finally breaks the last of Arant's resolve. He not only proposes a merger of the two companies, he also agrees to give the Trade Federation exclusive shipping rights to the Lomite from Dorvala. Thus, the Trade Federation gets the Lomite and Dorvala's vote in the Senate, and Gunray gets his seat on the Directorate. For his part, Darth Sidious is quick to remind Gunray just who he has to thank for this sudden windfall, and also remind the Nemoidian that nothing he does is beyond the Sith Lord's notice. The short story ends with Sidious praising Maul for his fine work, and advises him to prepare for his next assignment involving the criminal syndicate Black Sun. But that is a comic series and a story for another time. As a short story, Saboteur focuses on plot at the expense of characterization, but it is to Luceno's credit that he's able to convey something of Maul's character in these early days when his loyalty to Palpatine was still utterly fixed and unwavering. His ruthless efficiency, his impatient recklessness, and also his ability to manipulate. While not the puppet master par excellence that Palpatine is, it's clear that even then Maul had a talent for deception and manipulation, which is quite fitting given the trajectory that his character would ultimately go over a decade after this story was written. Other than that, the plot is well-paced, and the corporate sabotage conspiracy is well thought out. For that, Saboteur gets the Canon verdict. And so, in keeping with my earlier food metaphor, now you've enjoyed the appetizer, dear viewers. Tomorrow, the entree with Shadowhunter. Until then...